Mark chapter 16. We're going to read the story of the resurrection. We don't have kids' church today for 5 and up because we'd like the kids to stay in and hear the story and enjoy the baptism. So just 4 and under today, but as usual, we have all the way up to 5th grade. But we're just going to ask Holy Spirit for help. So Father, thank you for this morning. We ask that you would open up our eyes to the Word of God. We pray that each one of us could take encouragement and be challenged by the story of your resurrection today. In Jesus' name. Mark chapter 16. And when the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, bought spices that they might come and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, they came to the tomb when the sun had risen. And they were saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb?" And looking up, they saw that the stone had already been rolled away, although it was extremely large. And entering the tomb, they saw a young man sitting on the right, wearing a white robe, and they were amazed. And he said to them, "Do not be amazed. You are looking for Jesus the Nazarene, who has been crucified. He has risen. He is not here. Behold, here is the place where they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter, he is going before you into Galilee. There you will see him, just as he said to you." And they went out and fled from the tomb, for trembling and astonishment had gripped them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. Now after he had risen early on the first day of the week, he first appeared to Mary Magdalene, from whom he had cast out 7 demons. She went and reported to those who had been with him while they were mourning and weeping. And when they had heard that he was alive and had been seen by her, they refused to believe it. And after that, he appeared to them in a different form for 2 of them while they were walking along on their way to the country. And they went away and reported it to others, but they did not believe them either. I thought we had a fantastic service last Sunday, talking about Palm Sunday, the triumphant entry, and how Jesus entered into Jerusalem and they hailed him as king. And that same crowd on Sunday, that same crowd that Friday shouted, "Crucify him." There was such a turn of events, and you can imagine being part of that crowd, some of them even part of his crucifixion, and Mary and to the two Marys and some that stood there and watched him be crucified only to be raised from the dead, the astonishment and the unbelief that must have overtook them, but yet he showed and desired to reveal himself to them. I wanted to talk for just a minute about just how important is the resurrection. Around this time of year, I always ask the same question. So I kind of survey people as I'm out and about, usually the week around Easter. And I always ask people 2 questions. 1, do you believe that Jesus rose from the dead? So this week, I probably asked 100 people. And I'm not even sure if all 100 people were saved. But every single one of them said that they believed that Jesus rose from the dead. I think that you would be surprised how many people admit that they believe that Jesus rose from the dead. But the second question is, what implication does that have for your life? This year, only 2 people had an answer. And so it's always where I like to go personally when we gather together to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus. Because as believers, and maybe you're here and you don't know Jesus Christ yet.
Come on.
I believe some of us are going to meet him this morning. Yeah. But we've got to go beyond just believing and even celebrating that he rose from the dead. We've got to get to the place where we're actually understanding what that means for you and I. So just how important was his resurrection? I like Paul, and read the words of Paul in 1 Corinthians 15. He talks a little bit about the resurrection, and he makes it so plain. 1 Corinthians 15:12. He says, now if Christ is preached that he has been raised from the dead, how do some among you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then your preaching is vain, and so is your faith. Paul, tell us how you really feel. If Jesus Christ has not been raised from the dead, preaching, church, everything, it's fruitless, it's in vain. Verse 15, moreover, we are even found to be false witnesses of God, because we witnessed against God that he raised Christ, whom he did not raise, if in fact the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, not even Christ is raised. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is worthless, and you are still in your sins. Just how important is the resurrection of Jesus? If Jesus Christ was only crucified and he did not rise from the dead, Paul says that our faith is worthless and we're still in our sins. Who's ever heard of C.S. Lewis? Probably most of us. This is what C.S. Lewis says about the resurrection. The New Testament writers speak as if Christ's achievement in rising from the dead was the first event of its kind in the whole story of the universe. He is the first fruits, the pioneer of life. He has forced open a door that has been locked since the death of the first man. He has met, fought, and defeated the king of death. Everything is different because he has done so. John Piper, he said, to preach Christianity to the apostles was to primarily preach the resurrection. The resurrection is the central theme in every Christian sermon reported in the book of Acts. The resurrection and its implications were the gospel of the good news which the Christians brought. Brennan Manning, for me, the most radical demand of Christian faith lies in summoning the courage to say yes to the present risenness of Jesus Christ. Scholar N.T. Wright, Jesus' resurrection is the beginning of God's new project, not to snatch people away from earth to heaven, but to colonize earth with the life of heaven. That, after all, is what the Lord's Prayer is all about. Last one of my favorites, Warren Wiersbe. Now you might have to be over 50 to know who he is. Warren Wiersbe. Too many Christians are betweeners. They are trapped somewhere between Good Friday and Easter Sunday. They believe in the cross, but they never enter into the power and glory of the resurrection. It is clear that a believer cannot deliberately live in sin because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The believer has died to the old self and has been raised in Christ to enjoy a new life. The believer does not want to go back into sin any more than Lazarus wanted to go back into the tomb dressed in grave clothes again. Powerful. Just how important is the resurrection? I'd like to talk this morning and give you 4 points if you're taking notes. I want to talk about 4 implications of the resurrection. In other words, I believe that most of us, maybe all of us, believe that Jesus Christ rose from the dead. But I want to talk about how it can practically apply to our lives as believers. The first point, maybe we're all familiar with, is this. It's number one, the opportunity for eternal life. The opportunity for eternal life. Because Jesus Christ rose from the dead, he has given each and every one of us an opportunity for eternal life. John chapter 11, the mother of Lazarus comes to Jesus and says, well, if you had got here sooner, Lazarus wouldn't have died. So here in John 11:21, Martha therefore said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother, she was his sister, forgive me, not mother, would have not died. Even now I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give you. Jesus said to her, your brother shall rise again. Martha said to him, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection of the last day. Listen to Jesus' words in John 11:25. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me shall live, even if he dies. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? Jesus Christ is the resurrection and the life. All those who put their faith and trust in him will never die. Now, I don't know about you, I gave my life to the Lord as a little boy, and all growing up in the church, I have always been familiar with even Christians being afraid to die. And one of the scriptures that the Lord always takes me back to is Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14 and 15. Since then the children share in flesh and blood, he himself likewise also partook of the same, that through death he might render powerless him who had the power of death, that is the devil, and might deliver those who through fear of death were subject to slavery all their lives. Do you know that to fear death is to be in subject to slavery? Talk about an implication of the resurrection. Putting our faith and trust in Jesus, we're never going to die. Amen. What would it look like to have so much faith in the resurrection that you were freed from the fear of death? Because the truth is, we'll never die. I love John 17. It says, now this is eternal life, the knowledge of God. Jesus Christ dying on the cross and rising again, he has promised us eternal life, that we shall live with him forever, and that through faith in the resurrection we can even be feared, we can be freed from the fear of death. Number two, if you'll turn to Romans chapter 6, the first implication is that we have opportunity for eternal life. The second implication is that we are no longer slaves to sin. We are no longer slaves to sin. I believe that once you put your faith in Jesus, you will never be a successful sinner again. Again, this is an encouraging word, but it's a challenging word. I'm not talking about just giving mental assent that Jesus Christ rose again, but I'm telling you there's resurrection power that's living on the inside of you, and God has not only promised us eternal life after this one, but he has given us power and authority right now as we live. His blood and his resurrection have purchased a life free from the power of the sin nature, that we might walk in newness of life. That's good news. Salvation is just not fire insurance. I tell people, if I could list going to heaven on a top 10 list of why I serve God, it's like number 10. Doesn't that seem strange? There's so much more than when I die, I'm going to heaven. By accepting Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior and walking in the fullness of his resurrection, I can walk in freedom. You don't have to sin every day. Romans chapter 6. What shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace might increase? May it never be. How shall we who died to sin live in it any longer? Paul here in Romans chapter 6 is addressing the issue of grace, which we know in our culture today, there are so many false grace messages that are being preached in America. Grace is not a license to sin. Grace is a message where it empowers you up out of your sin and gives you an opportunity to lean into the grace of Jesus. So Paul here in Romans 6, he's addressing this issue. What shall we say then? Should we keep on sinning? The Greek here, it says, shall we continually and habitually live in sin because of grace? What's Paul's answer? Verse 2. May it never be. This is a Greek phrase, me genointo, meaning God forbid. Why? How shall we who died to sin live in it any longer? Paul said in Galatians 2:20, I was crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who lives, but he that lives in me. And so when we put our faith in the Son of God, that he died and he rose again, our old man, our sinful nature, is crucified with him on that tree, and the power of the sin nature is broken off of our lives. I always encourage people, don't be too hard on sinners because they're just doing what they do best. Sinners sin because that's their nature, to sin. They continually and habitually live in sin because it's the way that they've been hardwired. But I also encourage you, if you claim to be born again, you've been given a new nature. So what you once craved, you don't crave any longer. That's good news. Why should we continually and habitually live in sin? Well, we died to it. We've been crucified with him. It's no longer we that live, but he that lives in us. Powerful message. Verse 3. Or do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus have been baptized into his death? Or do you know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus have been baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him through baptism into death, in order that as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. Many of us are going to be baptized this morning. Wanted to speak to this for a second. What is baptism? Most of us know baptism as a public proclamation of faith. It's standing before friends and family and saying, I am unashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. But there's symbolism in the water. There's symbolism in standing or kneeling and going underneath the water, a full water immersion. And what it represents is I'm one way, and when I come out, I'm going to come out not the same way that I went down. So this Greek word for baptism, this is what it means. The introduction or placing of a person or thing into a new environment or into union with something else so as to alter its condition or relationship to its previous environment or condition. So when it says here, do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus have been baptized into his death? We were literally connected to the death of Jesus on the cross so that our DNA, our nature, might be altered. So when a person comes to Jesus Christ, and if you've been around me very long, I tell people I was bound in sin for many years because I was not armed with the truth of God's word. All spiritual warfare is centered on the knowledge of God. Many of us settle for mediocre Christian lives because we're not armed with the truth of God's word that, quite frankly, Satan doesn't want you to walk in. He doesn't want you to know that when you say yes to Jesus, it means you say no to something else. It means that the power of the sin nature, again, the continually, habitually living a life of sin, that power is broken when we bring Jesus Christ into our life. When we invite Him into our life as Lord and Savior, He comes in and He kicks out anything and everything that doesn't look like, act like, and talk like Him. So this is why I said, no one that is born again will ever be a successful sinner again.
Come on.
Part of the false grace message that's being preached from American pulpits is that you can come to Jesus and continue to continually and habitually live a life of sin and believe that you're going to heaven one day. I can tell you with all the love in my heart, that's not the gospel.
Right.
To me, that is not harsh. That is not condemning. If I knew someone was living in deception, and that deception could affect where they will spend all of eternity, I would rather offend them in person than have to answer to God when I stand before Him. There's a reason why it's called the good news. When we were standing here this morning singing, I was weeping, thinking about the whole plan of salvation. And this God has not only provided eternal life, that we will live with Him forever, He has provided an answer to our sin condition right now. So we're dead to sin. How can we live in it any longer? We've been baptized into His death. Therefore, we've been buried with Him through baptism into death, in order that as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. He broke the power of the sin nature off of your life. And you know what else He did? He gave you a new nature. That we might live a new life. If you're a believer in Jesus this morning, say, I have a new nature. This is one of the most profound truths of being a believer in Jesus Christ. We have been born again. He broke the power of the sin nature off of us, and He implanted a new nature. In other words, He rewired us. He gave us a new hard drive. What we once craved before Christ, we no longer crave in Christ because we have a new appetite. We have a new appetite. A.W. Tozer says, the once born will never understand the twice born. So I always like to encourage people, once you become born again, you're a weirdo. What it means to be born again is you turn in your resignation trying to fit into the world, and you sign up on learning how to stand out and be a disciple of Jesus Christ. No, you didn't hear me. That we might live a new life. This is why the apostles, when they wrote to the church in the book of Acts and the epistles, they wrote to them and didn't say, dear sinners. They said, dear saints. They said, holy ones in Christ Jesus. Are you standing out in your workplace? Paul and Peter, they wrote to the church, they called them strangers, foreigners, aliens, a peculiar people. We've been given a new nature.
Yes.
What we once craved, we don't crave any longer. What the world needs is not a bunch of hypocrites.
Oh, right.
And to be honest, what the world needs is maybe a church that struggles at times, but understands what the real grace of God is.
Yeah.
So that in our weakness, He can be made strong.
Yeah.
Yet the goal here this morning is not to condemn anyone. It's not to throw stones. But the gospel of Jesus Christ must be preached. The gospel of Jesus Christ is John 3:16. For God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. But do you know that the gospel is also John 3:36? John 3:36 says that those who reject the Son, the wrath of God continually and habitually abides upon them. You can't have the gospel and have one or the other. The gospel of Jesus Christ is a gospel of love and wrath.
Yes.
This is a weighty thing to believe, that the wrath of God right now is continually abiding upon those who do not know Him. How many have unsaved friends and family? The wrath of God is currently abiding upon them. How many of that grips your heart? And that's a weighty thing. Now we're not just talking about here. I mean, we live in a city. Maybe hundreds of thousands, the wrath of God is currently abiding upon them. But again, for God so loved the world, that no man would perish. No one is going to be able to stand before God at the end of the age and say, well, I didn't know. He's going to say, I gave you opportunity after opportunity after opportunity, and still you rejected me. And this is my heart in wanting to present people with the gospel is, listen, this is where you're at right now. This is where you're currently at with God, outside of the protection of Jesus. This is the condition that you're in, but there's good news.
Yeah.
Like if we don't preach, if we don't get into the bad news, it's not going to be good news.
Yeah. Right.
If you and I don't connect to our lives without Christ, we'll never be grateful for our lives in Christ. So the implications of the resurrection, all those who put their faith and their trust in Jesus have hope for eternal life. Number two, all those who put their faith and trust in the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ are free from the power of the sin nature. The third implication is all those who put their hope and trust in the resurrection of Jesus Christ have been given an opportunity to walk in newness of life. Fourth and finally, all those who put their faith and trust in the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and maybe my favorite, you are a minister of reconciliation. You are an ambassador. You have been called to share this good news of the gospel. And again, I want to encourage us as you go home and you celebrate with family and you meet people who believe that Jesus rose from the dead, I want us to ask ourselves personally, what does that mean in my life? To have the courage to ask people, okay, you believe that Jesus died and rose again, and maybe some of us will have those hard, awkward conversations where we talk to people that claim to know God but live like the world. We can take them back to the scriptures and say, brother or sister, this does not line up. You cannot claim to live in grace and continually and habitually live in sin. And they can say, well, why? And then you can just do a Bible study.
Yeah.
We died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? We've been baptized into His death and His burial. And when He was raised from the dead, And I'll close with this. The good news is you and I were raised up with him.
Come on.
I'll close in Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8. Verse 11. But if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus Christ from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. That same resurrection power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead is living in your mortal body. And I'm promising you, I'm prophesying to you that you can have victory over your struggles with sin today. Verse 12, it says, so brethren, we are under obligation not to the flesh to live according to the flesh. For if you are living according to the flesh, you must die. But if by the Spirit you are putting to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are being led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. I want to give you a truth and then we'll pray. Satan's strategy in your life as a believer in Jesus Christ, this is his strategy. He tries to resurrect what Jesus Christ killed on that tree. One more time. Satan's strategy, his only angle, if you're truly a believer in Jesus Christ, he is going to try to resurrect what Jesus Christ already crucified. This is why the Bible says, count it as a fact that you're dead to sin and alive in Christ Jesus. Satan tries to come into our lives and try to resurrect that nature that Jesus is already crucified. He's already rose again and gave you power and authority. So I walk around all the time and tell Satan to shut up. No, I'm serious. I tell him to get out of my head every day. I remind him of who has the victory to death, hell, and the grave. And this is part of walking in the newness of life. It's part of walking in kingdom power and authority, is recognizing Satan can only have what you give him. Well, brother, I can't break my pornography addiction. I'm telling you, in Jesus Christ, it's no longer you can't, but you won't. Because if you can't, that's an assault on the power of the cross. If you can't have victory in your marriage, that's an assault on the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The lack is not on his end. And this is the power and the glory of the cross and the resurrection is, he doesn't have to do anymore. We just have to put our faith and our trust in him.
Yeah.
I want to ask you this morning, if you're here, do you have a relationship with Jesus Christ? This is a service and a time where people come from all over the community seeking the Lord, asking questions. And I want to just give an opportunity for those who don't know Jesus Christ to come into a relationship with him, to put your faith and trust in his death, his burial, his resurrection again. We not only have hope for eternal life, there's freedom from the sin nature. There's opportunity to walk in newness of life. And you can even be an ambassador, a messenger of reconciliation, that he that knew no sin became sin, that we might become the righteousness of Jesus Christ. Amen. Maybe you're here this morning and you're struggling. You're saying, well, I've made a commitment to Christ maybe some years ago, but I'm one of those people that's continually and habitually living in sin. And now I'm not even sure if I'm saved. I want to tell you that there's hope today. Whether you don't know Jesus Christ, or maybe you committed your life at one time and you've backslid or you've fallen away and you want to rededicate your life to the Lord, I believe that there's no reason that anyone needs to leave here this morning not sure of where you would spend eternity, or not even sure that you can have victory over the power of the sin nature and what's against you in life. So I want to ask everyone just to close your eyes. If you're here this morning, you would like to make Jesus Christ Lord and Savior of your life, if you would like to receive the finished works of the cross, put your faith in the resurrection, whether for the first time, maybe you've fallen away from the Lord, maybe you're in a hopeless spot, overwhelmed by what's going on, you'd like to put your faith in Him, I want to ask you to just stand where you're at today. Anyone else? This is the good news. It's not for me. It's for Him. Let's stretch out our hands to those who are standing. These precious people that you brought here, not by mistake. We lift up their lives to you today. Now I want to encourage you, if you're standing, with your own words, to confess Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, to repent of your sins. I'm not going to lead you in a prayer. I encourage you to do it on your own. But right here, right now, confess Him as Lord, commit to turn away, and walk in the newness of life. The Bible says that you're a new creation. The old has passed, and the new has come. God, we even commit as a family to disciple them, to pour into them, to connect with them, to do our part in their lives. And we'll thank the Lord, all the glory, all the praise, all the honor. In Jesus' name, let's give a clap offering to the Lord. We're going to move into a time of baptisms. So we want to invite our choir up. Was that short-winded? How did I do? Oh, it's only, come on. A miracle just happened. You didn't even know it. We want to invite the choir up. Now at this time, as the choir comes up, if you're getting baptized, we want to go ahead and release you to get changed. So if you came to get baptized, and I want to make a bold statement. If you were one of those people that just stood, I want to encourage you, we'll baptize you in your Easter clothes. I believe in the power of baptism, a public declaration of our faith into the water, one way, out of the water, never the same, okay? So if any of you that just gave your life to the Lord, you say, you know what, I don't even want to walk out of here not baptized, I want to encourage you to do that, okay? So I'm going to go get changed, enjoy the choir. He needs my mic. Enjoy the choir. We'll come right back in and you can fix your gaze that way. All right, here we go. stand on just for one second. Sean, will you come? I want to ask everybody that's getting baptized, can you come over toward the pool? If you're already changed, make your way over. Everybody that's getting baptized, come to the front. There's a divine miracle that happened. And Sean is getting baptized. He's a new member of our family, and I've asked him, this is powerful, I've asked him to share what happened. So let's just give our attention. I'm going to ask him to share.
Hi, everybody. Praise God. I was in an accident last year and I had some injuries due to the accident. I got approved for a rotator cuff surgery in my left shoulder. They sent me for pre-op to the EKG blood work. They saw something in the EKG. They didn't share it with me, but they sent me for further physical. They sent me to a cardiologist. They found out that they wanted to do another EKG and what's called a cardiograph of the heart. Made a follow-up appointment after that. Cardiologist comes in, named Dr. Dostra. He comes in and he just dropped it off. He says, got a big problem for you. He says, your heart is a muscle. He said, it's supposed to contract like a full muscle does. He says, yours is weak. He says, so I want you to go to surgery. You could die on the table. I never expected to hear that. I went home, I shared with my brothers. I said, guys, I said, because I lost my mother back in October. I said, I guess I'm next, I don't know. I came here one week, and I enjoyed the service. Second week I came, sitting right over there where I am. With the same look, I decided to sit in the more comfortable chairs. I was called up, they called me up. I never explained nothing to anybody here, what I was going through, or what I had brought with me. He called me forward. He testified to me, he says, I don't want to read the whole thing, I'm just short that. It is. He testified to me that you're a father in my house. You have a father that loves you. And he explained to me that he was giving me a new heart. My heart would be restored. And I accepted every bit of that because it was spoken through God's vessels or mine right to me. And when he talked to me, he didn't just talk to me, he was talking to my soul. I don't know if you guys have ever had a word of God. That's the first word I'd ever had. Talk right to my soul.
Yeah,
and I accepted that. And you know, he talks about the devil comes to you and he didn't tell you shut up because he's trying to rob that from me. Like, hey, you know, you just got a word. What does that mean? He meant everything is what it meant. It meant my life.
Come on.
So it took them a while through the insurance to get the MRI set up. I went 2 weeks ago and laid an MRI and IV in your arm, and they put the dye through so they look at your heart. That's about two hour 45 minute procedure. They called me the following day and said, hey, we want some additional images. Can you come in on Friday? Yeah, a place of Sand Lake Imaging in Orlando. This one I went to was in Mainland. So they sent me the one closer in Orlando off of Turf Creek Road. Did the same thing. They told me it would take 10 minutes, but it ended up being like over an hour or so again. Well, not as long as the first, but close to. And I had a follow-up visit with the cardiologist on Monday. They still haven't received a full report. I was waiting. So they said, tell you what, let's go reschedule. So I rescheduled. Couldn't get another appointment to the following Wednesday. I got a phone call from the transportation company that Tuesday and said my appointment had been canceled. I didn't understand why. She said, well, maybe you want to call me. You know, just reschedule the appointment. So I called down there to the Central Florida College, just in Orlando. And I said, well, let me get you to his nurse. We'll see what they need you to do. So I called down there, and this nurse got on the phone with me. She says, Mr. Curry says, they got a reason for you even coming back here.
Today. So if you just want to watch on, we've got this row up here, okay? So here we go. What's your name? You have a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. You commit to follow him all the days of your life. Go ahead and kneel down. We baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
To follow him all the days of your life.
give the Lord a round of applause. Come on, we can do better than that. Let's just give it a shot. You too, everybody. Next week. All right, if you want to get baptized next week, I know you gave your life to the Lord. I'll baptize you next week right here. All right, let's grab each other's hands. Father, we thank you. So grateful for all that you've done. We thank you for salvation today. Thank you for deliverance today. Thank you for healing today. God, we thank you for healing Sean's heart. We release a healing anointing in this place in the name of Jesus. We pray over sick bodies. We pray over diseases and diagnosis. We say, be healed in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, thank you for our time together this afternoon, friends and family. We ask that you would be the center of it all. Enjoy the choir on your way out. God bless you guys so much. Thanks for coming. We'll see you next week. God bless you.